Chapter 24, Throwing Oneself.
Honey, it's okay if we die as long as we're together,
said Ellie, her voice pitched with fear. Brad grinned and held her hand. We aren't going to die yet. It's just a little weather. He had no problems with the turbulence, but she squeezed his fingers hard enough to make them blanch. Anticipating the unusual experience Ellie had planned for them, and knowing he wouldn't have to see Ota-san, Brad felt good about going back to Japan. Things had fallen into place as if arranged by a higher power, and that power would land their plane safely. When they hit another pocket of turbulence, the engine noises suddenly grew louder, and the plane banked sharply. Brad kept calm and rode it out while Ellie closed her eyes and chanted a sutra for protection. People groaned, and a baby made a shrill scream. The plane hit the runway minutes later with a bounce and a skid, the pilot fighting to keep control of the aircraft. Everyone was deathly quiet, except for the baby who was sobbing. When the vehicle began to slow, voices cropped up around the cabin and people pulled out their cell phones. They were soon in a taxi that took them out of the airport and onto a narrow highway. Brad admired the tree-covered volcanic mountains and clear blue skies, feeling a sense of peace with the world. He smiled in anticipation of the time he was about to spend among full-time Buddhist temple monks. After winding their way up a mountain for several miles, the driver dropped them off at a Buddhist temple grounds that held several low buildings. A tall, slender monk in ceremonial clothes was lighting incense at a small altar inside of a gate. When she saw the Westerners disembark, she came to greet them in broken English.
You are Rose Dare? Sensei, waiting.
She wore a knit cap that mostly covered her shaven head. Brad was captured by her pretty face and deeply melancholic eyes. Snowflakes stuck to her loose-fitting temple robe. She looks like a sad angel, thought Brad. The two women began chatting in Japanese.
This is Tenshin, said Ellie.
Konnichiwa,
said Brad with a slight bow. Tenshin took them to the temple master, who greeted them warmly. Ellie handed him papers and a sizable donation check, and they were fitted with traditional temple robes. The master was said to be fully enlightened in the Shingon Buddhist tradition, and had built the temple with his bare hands and the help of his first students 40 years ago. He led them through an ornate and private initiation ceremony, then gave the Rosedales Buddhist names, Chikong for Brad, and Aiku for Ellie, and blessed them. After the ceremony, Tenshin took them across the grounds to a construction site, where three monks were busy building a structure that was to become a storage shed out of cinder blocks and a wheelbarrow full of wet cement.
Good day, I'm Croton,
said a shaved head monk in a cheerful Australian accent. He bowed and added,
I am to guide you and translate during your stay.
A light flurry of snow swirled around them as they worked. Croton put down the trowel he was holding.
Follow me and I'll take you to your room.
The room was in the monk's unheated dormitory and was the same -2 degrees Celsius shown by the thermometer outside of Sensei's house. Ellie found a small space heater and dialed it up to max. Settling in quickly, they huddled together for warmth and were relieved when Croton came back to take them for dinner. As they crossed the grounds to the dining hall, they could see monks chanting scriptures, maintaining the temple grounds, and doing the cleanup. Sensei, as the monks addressed their master, did not believe in lazy hands or idle spirits. The Rosedales were brought into the dining hall where 15 full-time temple monks were gathering at a long table. Sensei sat in a large oak chair, a throne, thought Brad, by a massive stone fireplace that burned night and day. Food and drink flowed from the kitchen. Large plates of meat, fruit and vegetables, bowls of rice, baskets of warm bread, pots of fresh brewed tea, cans of Kirin beer and sweet-scented sake. Everyone pitched in. The long day of spiritual practice and temple work had the monks hungry. They were lean and showed few signs of aging except for Sensei, who nonetheless looked unusually well for a man in his 80s. Croton translated for the master.
We are honored to have Westerners from the U.S. who have come to do gyo, to purify the spirits and attain enlightenment.
Attain enlightenment. The words resounded in Brad's soul. I'm in the right place. How many of these monks have had their final enlightenment experience? He swelled with inspiration and couldn't wait to get started on gyo, whatever that was. Croton continued.
Sensei was happy to get Aiku's call 4 weeks ago and find that her husband wanted to stay at the temple and participate in the spiritual work with the monks. Westerners are rarely interested. I came from Great Britain 10 years ago, and look what happened. I'm still here.
Sensei was a large and jolly man who bore an uncanny resemblance to the Buddha. complete with flowing gold robes. He spoke Japanese in a low voice, and everything he said ended in "ha." The Rosedales were not surprised that dinner included beef and pork. Most Buddhists were not vegetarians. But the beer and sake, on the other hand, were unexpected, as was Sensei's constant thirst for the stronger drink. The Rosedales selected boiled shrimp and mixed vegetables to go with their miso soup and rice. The slender monks ate quickly, and no one spoke for several minutes as the hall filled with the delightful aroma of freshly cooked produce and farm foods. Utensils and chopsticks clicked on the plates until Sensei spoke. Croton continued to translate.
Sensei has a detailed program for your pleasure. He asked me to introduce the monks who will guide you during your two-week stay. First intention, he said, nodding to the tall monk whom they'd already met.
Tension placed her palms together and made a slight bow.
Konbanwa, chikan, and iku,
she said softly.
Tension will accompany you on Aruki Gyo, which is a walk down the mountain and back. You will leave a sign up in the morning. Next is Gyoshin. He will show you Hayakugyo. You will walk between two sacred posts 100 times.
A young monk with short black hair grinned and bowed over his dinner plate.
I am assigned to Mountain Gyo, Croton went on, which I've been doing every night for 2 years. Chikan, I will come to awaken you so we can get up to the mountain by midnight.
Climbing to sit on a mountain at midnight? Whoa, this is the real deal, thought Brad.
Miso Gyo,
said Sensei in a guttural tone almost like a bark looking at Brad. His eyes seemed to bulge forward in their sockets. He pointed at one of the monks, an older, squat fellow with a grim face. Ellie understood and grabbed Brad's elbow as if to alert him. There was tension among the monks.
Sensei wants you to do the cold water bath, Mizu Gyo.
Croton had hesitated before his translation.
Toro will take you. He will meet you at the gate at 3 a.m. He's been going every night for 5 years.
Toro grunted, reaching for a can of Kirin. Dinner finished up after 9 p.m. Some monks stayed for cleanup, while others went to do various duties, and a few went to the central hall where they would chant for the dead and world peace. There was no downtime. Dinner finished after 9 p.m. Some monks stayed for cleanup, while others went to do various duties, and a few went to the central hall where they would chant for the dead and world peace.
Chikan, Chikan-san, it is time for Mountain Gyo.
Croton stood outside the Rosedale's room, tapping on the door. It was 20 minutes to midnight.
Tell him you will start tomorrow,
Ile said, cuddling against her husband's chest. Brad stirred from sleep. No, if doing Gyo can enlighten me, I'm all in. He was still the child who had to make an A on his assignment, no matter how tired. Ellie pulled the blanket over her face as he climbed out of bed.
I'm coming, Croton.
He followed the monk to the main building, and they sat cross-legged by the furnace. Croton was thickly clothed. He handed Brad a blanket to wrap over his jacket, then a string of beads. The warmth was delightful, and Brad felt bad for his wife back in their cold room, alone, under the blankets.
Oh, the beads like this, Croton said. You count this way. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, until 99. Then you hold this strand and count the first bead as 100.
He explained further, showing Brad how the beads would keep track up to 1,000.
Then you start over for the next 1,000. Then you hold this strand and count the first bead as 100.
He explained further, showing Brad how the beads would keep track up to 1,000.
Then you start over for the next 1,000. I normally chant 5,000 times, but Sensei wants us to do only 2,000 so he can learn. Here's a sutra, continued Croton, handing Brad a half sheet of paper with a short paragraph of Japanese written phonetically in the English alphabet.
He does this every night, thought Brad. We are going to be chanting until breakfast?
Croton seemed to read his mind. It goes quickly, like this.
He chanted the sutra in a flurry of syllables that rolled off his tongue in a few seconds. Brad was impressed. He read the sutra, taking a quarter of a minute.
At that rate, we'll be up there all night, Croton said. No worries, do your best.
They put on their robes over heavy layers of clothes, and Croton performed a blessing chant for protection against the animal spirits that might try to harm them. Then they went out and around the building to face the edge of a forest. Snow lightly powdered the ground, lit by a floodlight mounted on the top of the building. But blackness enveloped them as they entered the trees. Brad followed Croton's flashlight as it traced the ground ahead. Soon they came to the base of a hill and had to hike. Brad clicked on his flashlight and put it in his teeth. They were climbing and pulling on roots or stones along a narrow path. Croton was silent, focused on the climb. Branches struck Brad as his gloved hands slipped on the rocks, where they were wet with snow. Up and up they went. Then they came to a clearing with a large rock in the center of it. A rope ladder hung over one side, and Brad followed Croton, who climbed up to sit on the massive rock. It looked about 12 to 15 feet in its outer dimensions.
You may start the chant, Chicken.
Brad held his flashlight in one hand, the paper in the other, and read. It felt even colder than just below freezing. Their breath came out in puffs of fog, and the air felt cold inside his nose, nipping at his hands and ears. He read it several times, and after some repetition, the syllables began to roll smoothly and quickly off his tongue. 2,000 and we are off this mountain. Go, 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 he urged himself. He knew he had to hit every word or Croton would catch him. By 100, he was getting faster. At 200, damn, it was cold. 300, 400, 500. Now he was ripping it. Nothing like Croton, but still, he was going to get them off this mountain before sunup. Animals fluttered and stirred, and leaves crunched in the darkness. Something moaned. Were there tigers in Japan? Maybe a monkey? Brad imagined a wild animal, something with big fangs and razor-like claws, leaping onto their rock and mauling them.
Mountain Gyo is to test your bravery against the animal spirits that might try to take us off our path,
Croton had said. And to think he had been coming up here every night alone. When Brad reached 1,000, Croton was matching him. Now the monk sped up. Brad rallied, his tongue relaxed, and the sound became more guttural, deeper and flowing. He was pinching the beads between his thumb and index finger, faster, faster, racing through them. It was cold and he was shivering now, his fingers going numb. Croton has adapted, but I haven't. He refused to give in. By the time they hit 2,000, he could barely feel the beads, and he was stiff all over. It was 2:30 in the morning.
Good job, Chicken, said Croton. Sensei will be proud. Let's climb down and warm up.
Brad followed the Aussie, the only Westerner to live in the temple as a monk, down the rope ladder and down the steep trail where the new arrival slipped on loose dirt and had to grab roots and rocks to keep from falling. The trail finally leveled out and they returned to the temple grounds and into the hall where the furnace welcomed them with its radiant heat. Brad had scratches on his face from the rocks and tree branches. His back was stiff and a knee was sore from twisting it when his foot caught on a root. Even so, it was nothing he couldn't shake off on his mission to achieve enlightenment.
You should mate Taro now for Mizugyo, said Croton. I think they're just in time.
I was supposed to meet him at the gate, said Brad.
Ah, yes, let's go there. Maybe I'll join you for a dip.
They went out to the gate, but Taro wasn't there.
I think we missed him, said Croton. Sorry, Chika-san. You have to join him tomorrow.
Brad didn't feel bad at all. He made it back to Ellie and climbed in bed. She mumbled but didn't awaken, and he fell immediately into a deep sleep. Sensei knew that Chika missed his Mizugyo, for Taro made it known after he returned from the cold water pool. At 6 a.m., tension came to awaken the Rosedales. They went to the hall, and in their robes, they took part in an incense ceremony. They were then handed walking sticks with carefully inlaid carvings that repelled evil spirits, and sent off down the mountain just as the sun peaked over the horizon, and the pre-dawn glow became a brilliant flash of yellow light. There were scattered clouds, but it had stopped snowing, and it was supposed to warm up. Making their way down the winding road, they could catch sight of the picturesque town of Kagoshima in the distance. The town was right on the water, and the vast blue of the Sea of Japan stretched to the horizon. This must be the Izugyo, Brad said to Ellie. I can walk down the road and back. They were warm in layered clothes under their robes, gloves on, and knitted caps. Ellie and Tenshin chatted in Japanese and laughed. Brad learned that the monk had been making the walk every other day for 2 years. It was her main form of spiritual practice. On the other days, she tended the grounds, pulled weeds, watered plants, and restocked supplies in the temple's little gift shop, where visitors came on weekends to get blessings from the master and buy souvenirs as gifts and for good luck. The Rosedales kept pace with Tenshin easily. Water bottles and snacks for lunch were secure in small backpacks. How far is the walk anyway? Brad wondered aloud. Ellie translated and returned Tenshin's answer.
About 26 kilometers.
What? I think that's about 16 miles, said Brad, doing the math in his head. That's more than a half marathon. I've never walked that far in my life, but it's only a walk, he added, keeping this particular thought to himself. Piece of cake. Halfway down the mountain, they were enjoying the majestic view in the frigid air. They arrived at the seaside town and stopped at a monument near the water's edge, lit incense, and chanted for 30 minutes. Tenshin spread out a blanket, and they ate slices of bread, cheese, and fruit. Brad had severely underestimated the walk back. It began gently, taking a couple of turns through the small town, and then following a long road with traffic. After some miles, however, the road narrowed, and they had to hug the shoulder to give room to cars. Brad's knees started to ache. Ellie wasn't having any problems, but fatigue was setting in for her husband. No one spoke for 2 hours. At last, tension stopped for a break as the road became very steep. The two women spoke in Japanese and began laughing. Brad wondered if it was about him. His back was killing him, so he did some stretches and shook it off. They arrived back at the temple 6 hours after sunrise. Brad was spent. Most visitors to the temple came from the local or surrounding prefectures on weekends. They were happy to walk around the temple grounds, stopping at some of the ornate altars where they would chant and light candles. Then they would sit in the central hall where the monks would lead them in the chant for world peace and to honor the dead. Sensei had designated a priest who would come and bless them to help rid their spirits of the negative energy, the aku, and on their way out, they would stop at the gift shop to buy souvenirs and charms. The more energetic visitors might do hayoku kyo, chanting a blessing at each post, taking about 2 hours. The Rosedales came to do hayoku kyo, a day after their 16-mile aruki kyo. Brad's back and knees were still a little stiff, but he knew the exercise would do him good. When Gyoshin showed them how to do hayoku kyo, Brad laughed. That'll be a breeze. He sized up the two ornate columns that stood 70 feet apart and considered walking back and forth between them, stopping just long enough to recite a breath chant and drop a bead into a bowl fastened to the column. The ritual was to be repeated 100 times, 100 being hayoku in Japanese. The couple took off at an easy trot, reached the opposite post, stopping just long enough to chant the blessing, and dropped a bead into a bowl. Back and forth they went. Brad was careful not to aggravate the chondromalacia in his knee. It had been 3 years since he'd had arthroscopic surgery, and the knee had been stable. Ellie showed no signs of fatigue. Good for us that we go to the gym regularly, Brad thought. Back and forth, another chant, another bead. They were running shoulder to shoulder together. A couple of visitors stopped and watched, smiling and cheering them on. The sack of beads was getting smaller and smaller. But when they were past the halfway point, Ellie slowed to a walk.
Don't worry about me. I'll finish on my own, she said.
Okay, said Brad. Perspiring, he pushed himself to speed up. By the time his bead sack was empty, sweat had soaked through his clothes. Storm clouds were coming, and a few flakes of snow drifted around them. The visitors were long gone. 30 meters away, Croton and a couple of monks were up on ladders working on the storage shed, finishing the walls. Brad sat on a bench near the Yokyo course while Ellie finished. As if on cue, Gyoshin appeared. Very good, he said in decent English. Ellie had 10 more and she sped up and started running again. Brad watched her and felt his heart reach out to his caring wife. She doesn't want to keep us waiting. So sweet.
She can't. You did very well. Aku, do you enjoy?
Gyoshin had a big toothy grin and his ear stuck out. With his short black hair, he made Brad think of Mickey Mouse.
Haiku kyo is not my favorite. It looks easy, but it's a lot of work. Skoshi atai no daijoubu desu.
Brad was trying to say that he had a little pain, but it was okay. He wiggled his knee, which felt like it was a bit out of joint, but it didn't hurt to bear full weight on it. They watched Ellie as she dropped her final bead and joined them, breathy and sweaty. She spoke rapid Japanese with Gyoshin, who bowed at her. Then he bowed to Brad.
Gyoshin made a joke. He holds a temple record for hayaku gyo, and he invited you to try to break it,
said Ellie.
Oh,
said Brad. The mention of breaking a record made him surge with curiosity and interest.
What is his record?
He did 400. Nobody has beaten it,
said Ellie, after translating the question and answer.
Wow. It would take all day. When can I do it?
Joking. It is too much. You can't try that,
said Ellie.
Why not? Let me try. Give me a couple of days to prepare.
He would have to cut out aruki gyo to save his knees. Mountain gyo would be okay, though, and mizu gyo.
Gyoshin said, if you want to try, he would be honored,
Ellie said. You're on, Gyoshin, said Brad. They bowed at each other and smiled. It was on. The day came, and after an early breakfast, Ellie and Gyoshin watched Brad take off at an easy trot as the sun rose into the sky, a bag of 100 beads in hand. 4 more sacks sat on the north altar. He would have to empty all of them. It had to be 500 to beat Gyoshin, not a bead less. 401 wouldn't count. Ellie left for Aruki Gyo with tension, and Gyoshin went to help with the storage shed, returning periodically to check that it was done correctly. It was his record, after all. The first 100 went easily for Brad, completed in less than an hour. The second 100 wasn't bad, but he was slowing. He checked his watch. It had taken almost 2 hours. The third hundred started to hurt. There was a sharp pain in his knee when he pivoted on it, which he tried to avoid. And his back was stiffening. His feet started to hurt. Before he reached 300, he was walking and developed a slight limp. Hot and sweaty, he stopped to take off his outer clothing. Gyoshin appeared again.
Oh, genki desu ka? How are you, Chikan?
I'm fine, Brad lied.
I have 200 more to break your record.
So, desu ne?
The monk looked concerned and hurried back to his duties elsewhere, but kept an eye on. Brad walked as quickly as he could, hoping he could recover enough to resume jogging. The 400 seemed to take forever, and it was past lunchtime when he reached it. He had been drinking bottled water and had to pee fiercely. Gyoshin reappeared with Croton.
Hey, chicken, how many?
I'm almost 400. Can I take a break to pee?
No breaks. Gyoshin did 400 without a break. Sorry, you can quit any time.
I don't think so, Brad muttered to himself.
No, I'm good.
He kept walking and let his urine go, which soaked his crotch and partway down the leg of his pants. He wrinkled his nose in a grimace, but didn't care if they noticed or not. He was going to break the record. The two monks left. Later, Gyoshin returned, and by that time, Brad had about a dozen beads left to reach 500. He was limping and shuffling back and forth between the posts as best as he could with a stiff spine, sore feet, and a knee that throbbed and sent sharp shooting pains up the back of his thigh. The urine had mostly dried, but was irritating the skin of his groin. Gyoshin watched as Brad broke his record and became the second foreigner in history to set a temple record, after Croton, who had set the record for Mountain Gyo chants.
Very good,
Gyoshin said as he clapped his hands politely. But he wasn't smiling. He would have to report to Sunsi that Chikan had broken his Hayoku Gyo record. Ellie came. She and Tenshin had just returned from their 16-mile Aruki Gyo mountain walk. The Rosedales retired to their room where they took showers and napped in bed until dinner. Brad could barely get out of bed, and wouldn't have if it weren't for the great appetite he'd built up by exercising most of the day and skipping lunch. At dinner, Sensei recognized Brad's performance in setting the Hayaku Gyo record, and everyone applauded and cheered.
We will invite Brad to do Misu Gyo tonight,
Master continued, Ellie translated. They learned that the cold water Gyo was rarely done by any visitors and never in the dead of winter, except by the most dedicated monk, Toru.
How am I going to set a record for that? Brad asked his wife.
I guess you can stay in the water longer,
she said in fun without thinking it through.
Good idea.
I'll show them,
said Brad. The delicious hot food and warm cheer from the monks refreshed him, and after dinner he limped back to rest again in their room, which was holding some warmth thanks to the small space heater they kept on constantly.
Honey, are you going to do Misu Kyo tonight?
Ellie wanted to talk him out of it.
I have to, and the cold water will probably be good for my feet and knees.
The thought made him laugh, a weak laugh that ended abruptly when he imagined squatting in the freezing water with his stiff back. It was only the Rosedales' third day at the temple, and they had already been pushed out of their comfort zones. They had completed the exhausting mountain walk and run back and forth between posts. Brad had been sitting on a rock at midnight, chanting every night. The only break they had was when they chanted for world peace in the central hall or lit candles around the temple grounds. Brad was completely unprepared for his most severe test. Brad awoke to the whine of his travel alarm clock, which read 2:30 a.m. 15 minutes later, he was at the gate to meet Toru. The monk appeared, surprised that he was there.
Chikan-san, konbanwa. Konbanwa,
Toru.
Dajubu desu ka?
Brad said politely.
Dajubu desu,
growled the short, bald, stocky monk. Toru beckoned, and Brad followed him past the gate. It had started snowing again, and the path was slippery on their steep climb down. His blistered feet hurt in his shoes as he stepped on the rocky ground, and stabbing pain shot through his knee when he had to pivot on it. After several minutes, he could hear the musical tinkling of a small waterfall that emptied into a small pool built by hand from natural rocks and cement decades ago. Completing the descent along the treacherous path in darkness, they came to stand in a clearing where their breath fogged, and Toru began to disrobe. Brad tried to stretch his lower back, but it was in spasm and wouldn't budge. Because of the rare January snowfall, the water from the mountain spring was freezing, and the air on the thermometer outside the main building measured -2 degrees Celsius. Setting a small flashlight on a rock to illuminate the scene, Toru stripped off his underclothes and strolled out into the pool with nothing but a plastic bucket. Then he lowered himself into a sitting position. Brad watched as the monk chanted, raking the bucket through the freezing water in a frenzy, splashing it onto his face and chest, again and again, his voice tremulous.
Kanji zabo saigyo jin han nya ha ra mi ta ji. Kanji zabo saigyo jin han nya ha ra mi ta ji.
Shouting the chant as though to fight off the cold and gasping after every few syllables, he chanted the entire Heart Sutra. The words flurried rapidly on his tongue, and he completed the ritual in less than a minute.
He's cheating. I'm going to do it right, Brad thought.
Toru rose and crossed the sandy bottom of the pool and stepped out onto the snow-covered ground. In the beam of the flashlight, he was silhouetted against the waterfall against the cloud-moonless sky. He reached the post, grabbed his towel, and in seconds was dry and had started donning his long thermal underwear and robe. He then took the flashlight and signaled Brad to go into the water. He seemed unaffected by the exposure. Removing his robe, Brad peeled off his underclothes and hung them on posts a few meters from the pool. When the cold air hit his naked body, he was resolute and didn't slow.
I am going to show this monk how to do it. I will set a record and impress Ellie, too.
Toru aimed the flashlight at Brad's feet and moved the beam to guide him into the water. Stepping in with one leg, then the other, he gasped and gritted his teeth.
I will show them.
He marched to the middle of the pool. As the cold water began to suck the heat out of his body, something strange happened. The part of his mind that willed him to move split off, leaving another part to think and feel. The part that willed him to lower his body until it was sitting in the water up to chest level. The feeling part began to panic.
I can't breathe. Oh!
The words were screaming in his head. The part that willed him fought the panicking part and allowed a sharp gasp of air before forcing the chant he had spent hours memorizing.
Kan chi za piao, kan chi za piao, kan chi za piao, kan chi za piao.
He was cut off by another gasp and choked. The feeling part reeled at the agony of his naked body in the icy water. It felt like being burned alive or getting dipped in acid. The thinking part resounded through his entire being.
You're going to die. Get out.
Then the part that willed him, the part that fed his competitiveness, took over. It alone knew since childhood that failure was worse than death.
Do this or die.
Instead of splashing the water frantically like Toru had, which could preserve some vestige of body heat, Brad forced himself to breathe and fill the bucket calmly, put it over his head and shoulders and chant the Heart Sutra, starting from the beginning. He poured deliberately, making sure to drench his entire upper body over and over. He made a show out of it.
I am in control. I am doing it better than Toru.
The part that willed him to move carried on. The other part of his mind fell in line.
Toru will tell the master, and everybody will recognize my spiritual achievement.
As he finished the chant, his voice turned to gasps and coughs. Then he sat still, breathing in shuddering sighs. A moment of peace and calm came, and the cold did not bother him.
I am in control. I can do it better.
He sat motionless, waiting. Finally, the competitive part was satisfied and allowed his body to stand up. The thinking and feeling part of him surged.
I can't feel my legs. I can't feel my legs.
The movement part went on autopilot, and the thinking part watched in fear as his legs followed Toru's flashlight beam step by step to the edge of the pond. The thinking part had to use his hands to lift each leg over the wall of the pool and onto the snowy rocks. They were like someone else's legs and felt cold and rubbery. The flashlight beam guided him. He watched his legs move, but could not feel them or the ground. He was shivering, and Toru had to place the towel in his hand. He stumbled, catching the post to keep from falling.
Chikan, put on, put on! Chikan, put on, put on!
The monk was speaking broken English, sounding anxious, holding out the thermal underwear. At first, he couldn't get his leg in. Then, finally, he could. But he lost balance and sat down hard on a patch of ice. Then he got the other leg in. As Toru held the thermal shirt over him, Brad was shuddering and gasping as he got his arms into it and pulled it down around his chest.
Getting the robe on, fumbling with his socks, throwing them away, getting his shoes on, the thinking and feeling part became a survival instinct and pushed him to keep his body alive.
Brad followed Toru up the path and continued to gasp and shiver with no feelings in his legs. Unable to stay balanced, he had to use his hands and knees much of the way, slipping on patches of snow, scraping his knees. His breath made puffs of steam in the frigid night. His stomach felt like it was full of rocks. As they crested the hill, Toru turned and pulled him up by his feet. He offered to take Brad's arm, but was pushed away. I'm going to walk into the hall on my own goddamn feet. The competitive mind that had caused his hypothermia was making for a losing fight. As his dead legs trudged across the temple grounds, he started dry heaving, his guts retching painfully. When they made it to the central hall, another monk appeared and both monks sat him in front of the furnace and began wrapping him in blankets. He shivered uncontrollably, his core temperature dangerously low. Where was the heat? He couldn't feel it emanating from the big stove burning 2 feet away. Ellie came, having been awakened by a frantic monk. She pulled his shoes off, finding his feet blue and bleeding, and cleaned them with a warm washcloth. There was dirt under his fingernails and abrasions over his knees, hands, and wrists. Her voice sounded distant, as if he were dreaming.
Brad, can you hear me? Brad! Brad, say something!
She hugged him and held him and looked angrily at Toru, who just stood there. Toru spoke Japanese with a dark tone of voice.
I'm fine. I feel sick, but it's getting better.
Brad's voice was weak and hoarse.
Toru said you stayed in the cold water for a long time. Why did you do that?
She said, worrying in her voice.
He was cheating, taking shortcuts. I wanted to show them that I could do it right.
I was joking about you setting a record in the cold water. I'm so sorry.
Tears were streaming down her cheeks. Another woman might have yelled at him and called him a fool, not Ellie. Her heart was breaking at the sight of her husband in pain, the victim of his prideful and competitive nature. It was then that the headache started. They came from the base of his skull, like an iron spike being driven into his brainstem. Pounding and throbbing, they shot up and around the sides of his head and into his eyes. Each throb was an explosion in his brain. He groaned, twisting and turning, trying to find a position that relieved the pounding in his skull.
Oh, God.
He got on his elbows and knees, holding his head in his hands, pulling on it as if stretching his neck would help.
I want to rip my head off my body.
Saliva drooled from his mouth and puddled on the floor. Ellie's attention, which usually offered him relief, was futile. Toru looked on, eyes hard, jaws set like a stern father. He did not need a blanket or to be near the furnace. He held out a cup of hot tea, but Brad was too ill to take it. Aku, aku, he said. He and another monk laid their hands on the top of Brad's head and began chanting the Heart Sutra rapidly, over and over. They believed that the Westerner had lots of aku that needed to be released. In the Shingon religious sect, aku was equivalent to evil spirits or bad energy. After a while, the headaches abated enough for Brad to sit up. Huddled in blankets in front of the stove, he drank the hot tea until he felt warm. Around sunup, Ellie got him to bed and he drifted off to sleep until time for the noon meal. At lunch, the master proclaimed that the great doctor from the West had an amazing Mizu-kyo, which brought up much aku, and now his spirit was cleansed and closer to attaining enlightenment. He urged all of the monks to practice harder. Ellie translated into Brad's ear, which caused him to look at Toru. The monk sneered and crumpled the can of Kirin beer in his hand.
I don't want to make enemies, Brad thought. And besides, another round of Mizu-kyo might kill me.
Brad went for his nightly mountain kyo ritual with Croton. He had developed a deep admiration for the rugged monk, imagining him sitting on the rock alone every night at midnight for years, with wild animals stirring around him in the forest. That deserved respect. They climbed the rope ladder onto the rock, but before chanting, Brad had to know something. His curiosity ran deep.
Are you enlightened, Croton? Have you had your final realization of the absolute?
He hoped that Croton had achieved it. The monk was pleasant and had a sense of maturity and contentment that was rare.
No, a wish. That's why I stayed here. Sensei promised if I did exactly as he instructed, I would get my enlightenment. That was 10 years ago, and he hasn't recognized me yet.
10 years should be enough, though, don't you think?
I don't know, said Croton.
He looked at the beads in his hands, ready to begin counting, and Brad avoided further discussion of the subject. The ritual took over, and they began chanting together. Brad was faster from the nightly practice, and they finished in 2 hours. Croton was happy to return to the central hall by 2 a.m., which was earlier than usual. But he would have to report to Sensei after sunrise.
I hate to tell Sensei that we are finishing early. He is likely to increase our chance.
sensing that Croton preferred less time on the rock, somehow made Brad doubt the monk's devotion to attaining enlightenment. Brad tried to imagine Croton's 10 years in the temple and not getting enlightened. 10 years of throwing himself to God. 10 years of nightly spiritual exercises, the nonstop toil, the surrender and dedication. He looked at Croton, and the horror of failure came upon him like a dark shadow. A fear of loss that screamed,
no,
in his soul. He saw the futility of doing the kyo for attaining enlightenment. Days went by, and the Rosedales continued the kyo, except for the cold water bath. After Brad's hyperthermia, he had enough eku for the entire trip. They chanted for world peace and enjoyed the sumptuous meals that the monks prepared every day. Sensei gave evening lectures about animal spirits and told stories of his childhood and how he was guided by God 40 years ago to come to Kagoshima and build the temple. The following day, the Rosedales wandered across the temple grounds to chant in the hall, but didn't look over at Hayuku Gyo posts. If they had, they would have seen Gyoshin jogging back and forth, chanting loudly, throwing his bead into the basin with each pass. It was lunchtime, and all the monks were there except for Gyoshin. Somebody was always missing, so nobody said anything. They would take turns shopping for food and supplies or running the gift shop when visitors came. After lunch, everyone followed Sensei's suggestions to do the basic Gyo and chant for world peace in the central hall, which took half the afternoon. Then the Rosedales retired to their room. It had warmed up a bit, and the temperature was in the 40s, the snow having all melted. Brad grabbed Ellie and kissed her. They hadn't enjoyed each other for many days. Ellie reminded him of Sensei's strict rule. But we're married, honey, said Brad.
It's not comfortable, and we have no privacy. There isn't even a lock on the door.
It spoiled the mood, but he understood. They embraced under the covers and slept. Dinner time came, and everyone assembled in the dining hall. Croton had an announcement.
Chicken Song broke Gyoshin's record for Hayuku Gyo the other day when he did 500. Sensei was very impressed. Gyoshin responded to the challenge today and succeeded in doing 600. Gyoshin has reclaimed his record. Chikan has challenged to try to beat him.
Gyoshin appeared fresh and showed no signs of wear and tear from an ordeal that must have taken 8 hours. Damn, that record didn't last long. He must have peed on himself too, thought Brad. He curled his toes in his shoes and felt the sore and still healing skin on the soles of his feet stretch painfully. His knee still hurt when he would turn a corner.
Oh, thanks. You can keep your record,
Croton translated for the group. Gyoshin and Sensei beamed proudly. On the afternoon of the following day, Tenshin came through the gate, finished with her Aruki Gyo. Brad's feet were feeling better, and he asked Ellie if they could go mountain walk again. The two ladies chatted in their native language for a moment before Ellie answered his question.
She will go again in 2 days, but if you make a special request, Sensei may let her take us tomorrow.
Yes, tell her I would like to go in the morning. The message was conveyed, and Sensei authorized the trip. They set off at sunup the following morning. The walk was invigorating and got Brad to thinking about his failure to set a temple record for Hayuku Gyo. Ask Tenshin if any of the monks have done this walk 3 days in a row, he said to Ellie. Japanese was spoken back and forth, and the monk began laughing.
Not in the years that she has been doing it,
she said.
She wants to know if you want to try.
Tell her I will do it and set an Aruki Gyo record for the temple, said Brad. He couldn't fail this one. He had to set at least one record that would stand against the monks. The lady spoke in Japanese again and giggled, having become close from their hours of walking and performing temple service together. The threesome resumed their walk along the winding road, which took them down into the town and around the seashore. Ellie and Tenshin spoke much of the way, while Brad took in the subtle fragrances of the mixed sea and mountain air, and enjoyed the panoramic vista which changed as they walked. He imagined Tenshin making the same walk every other day. It would have been hundreds of times. How good the practice must be for the mind, body, and soul. Maybe she had achieved enlightenment. But if she had, why would Sensei keep her doing it? They got back to the temple in the early afternoon. Tenshin went off to her duties, and Brad checked his feet, finding a few mild blisters. Ellie felt stiff, but shook it off and found some snacks.
I want to share some stories from Tenshin, she said.
Sure, said Brad, preparing for some temple gossip. I'm all ears, honey.
Sit down and be still. This will break your heart.
He stopped rustling about and sat on the bed.
Tenshin told me about how she came to be a monk. She had a strict father in a suburb of Tokyo, and when she became a teenager, she would escape from the house and go to Shibuki with her friends, where she was introduced to cosplay.
They would go around in wild, colorful outfits and makeup and act like anime characters from stories. It was fun, but she also was being rebellious. Tenshin was the tallest of her friends, and she had played volleyball and was considered very attractive. So she would get propositioned by older men. Her father tried to control her and would forgive her, until one day she dyed her hair pink. He became angry and disowned her, so she had to move out at the age of 16. She became a low-level hostess in a bar in Ginza, cleaning and taking out trash just to survive, and shared a room with a co-worker. But she worked hard and got a promotions. The customers liked her, and she made extra money escorting them. She even took classes in culture and literature, so she could advance. After a few years, she had a high-rise apartment and was driving a BMW. One of the clients she escorted was the CEO of a technology startup. They had good times, and she fell in love with him, but found out he was married. She was heartbroken and quit work, lost her BMW, and was evicted from her apartment. She went back home and begged her parents for a room to stay. As soon as her father learned she had been working as a hostess in a bar, he refused. Her mother advised her to go to the temple in Kagoshima, where she could get a blessing to rid herself of evil spirit and do spiritual practice, and then come back to talk to the father. That was 15 years ago, and Tenshin has been here ever since. She is one of Sensei's most trusted monks now.
That's an amazing story. Tenshin hasn't seen her parents in all those years. Brad could easily picture how she looked in her younger years with long, beautiful hair.
Her mother comes every year to visit and chant for world peace, and they visit then.
The next morning, Tenshin spoke to Sensei, who authorized Brad's request to set an Aruki-gyo record by making the mountain walk 3 days in a row. When the master announced it at dinner, the monks looked at each other in surprise, whispered, and then grinned broadly. Ellie translated that they found him entertaining, and they liked his gaijin, meaning foreigner, very much. When Brad woke up and took off for his second walk, a male monk led the way, walking faster than the Rosedales had done with Tenshin. On the way back, Brad struggled to keep up, pushing up the mountain with an aching back and knees for a total time of just under 5 hours. His feet felt raw, but when Ellie checked them, there were only a few more blisters. Calluses were forming too. His feet were toughening up. He soaked them in warm salt water and elevated them that evening. Preparing for the third day, ready to set the record, he learned that Ellie didn't want to go. She had had enough, but he couldn't go with Tenshin. Sensei had strict rules, which included that a female monk could not be alone with one man. They asked around, but the male monks were all busy doing their assigned tasks. Ellie, tell Master I can go by myself. I can find the way. I'll just stick to the main road and be back in less than 5 hours.
That is not a good idea. Give it a break. Your feet need to rest, and you look stiff just getting out of a chair.
Nah, it's a piece of cake. The easiest gyo of all. I'm good. Can you ask him?
The master was delighted. He announced that not only was the great doctor from the West going to set a record for a Aruki gyo, but he was going to honor the temple by being the first foreigner to ever do the long walk by himself. The monks clapped and snickered, and Brad felt a warm glow inside. The next morning, he waited 2 hours after Tenshin had left for a mountain walk. He wondered if he might be able to pass her on the way. Wearing an extra pair of socks, packing a very light lunch and no blanket, outfitted with his ceremonial robe and walkstick, he took off at a slow jog as Ellie waved goodbye. Down the hill he went. After about an hour of jog walking down the mountain, he was sweating and had to strip his jacket off and stuff it into his backpack. Another hour later, he was at the seaside monument where he finished the chanting well ahead of schedule. I can beat 4 hours, he thought, which spurred him to ignore the stabbing pain in his kneecap. He resumed his trek and ate his lunch while marching with rapid steps, not wasting time for a sitting break. He couldn't know that Tenshin had finished her lunch just minutes before he had arrived and was on her way back up the mountain. If he had taken the correct road back, he would have caught up with her. But he didn't. He made a wrong turn. He walked straight toward the mountain. There were fewer buildings along the way. Then there were only people's houses and then fields. When it was obvious he had gone the wrong way, he turned back and went toward the ocean. He could look back and see the monument. It seemed to be the right road, and yet it swung around towards some small factories. He retraced his steps again and took a third route, until that became unfamiliar.
Finally, he stopped and counted how many ways he could go. There were 5. The thought came that he was trapped in an episode of Night Gallery or Outer Limits, the TV series he'd loved so much as a kid, the shows he watched sometimes when Mo wasn't around to command the living room. Kogoshima was a portal to an alternate universe, and now he was never going to return. Maybe the monks had placed a curse on him. He walked along the water's edge until he was in a part of the town that bordered the seaside, with no main road anywhere to be found. The thought of being lost was humiliating. Wait, it's only one road. He would just go back up the same damn mountain he had come down and end up at the temple grounds where he had started. Brad set out marching purposefully, tapping the stick on the ground with each step. The road began to rise into the foothill. It's only one road, he kept telling himself. But then it veered left and headed around another part of the mountain. He kept walking. His feet felt swollen in his shoes. He was breathing hard and thirsty. The water was gone and he had to urinate. Cell phones were not allowed during Kyo, and there were no taxis to call anyway. He thought about flagging a car down, but realized he wouldn't be able to give directions. He just kept walking. A car pulled over in front of him. His pride broken, he accepted the ride. Someone had reported a lone man walking back and forth on the roads, and a city official had been summoned. Their driver knew where to take him because the name of the temple was engraved on the walking stick. It was almost sunset by the time Brad made it back to the temple. Dinner was being served. He limped onto the temple grounds and found some water. Ellie was anxiously waiting. They had received a call.
Oh no, poor thing. You got lost.
It felt like I stumbled into another dimension where all roads led nowhere. Did you know 5 different routes are leading away from the seaside monument? I should have had a damn map. I hope I still get credit for a record. I'm sure I walked more than 26 kilometers today.
Honey, that's the bad news. One of the monks still holds the Arukigyo record.
Ellie was trying to let him down easy. As they settled into chairs at the long table in the dining hall, a bald monk grinning ear to ear sauntered in, carrying a pair of his shoes. He came over to where Brad was sitting and showed him the athletic shoes with deformed soles where the rubber had been worn away, places where they were almost completely worn through.
This is Shoshan,
Ellie said, introducing to Brad.
Sensei assigned his Arukigyo 3 years ago to walk across Japan from north to south. It took him a month and he wore out 3 pairs of shoes. He holds the record for Arukigyo.
The monks all grinned at Brad and were trying not to laugh. He was humbled again. Tenshin was sitting next to Ellie and whispered into her ear. Ellie turned to Brad, mouth open, eyes wide, then covered her mouth as if she were afraid of the words that would come out. What? Is something wrong? Brad asked. Ellie recovered.
Tenshin says they knew all along that you wouldn't break the Arukigyo record. Walking up and down the mountain is considered just a basic gyo. Many of them have done 100-kilometer walks. They set you up for a joke.
The monks understood that Ellie was letting Brad in on their fun.
Sai, Chikan-san, came the replies. No hard feelings, Rosel, Kyoshin
said in clear English. Only Croton could save himself.
Chikan-san, I wasn't in on it, mate. No harm was done, though. You might think of it as a lesson in humility.
Sensei surveyed the scene like a grinning Buddha, his sake glass in hand. Everyone then dug in to enjoy a hearty meal. Brad felt his temples throb. Too bad he couldn't come up with a witty retort in their language, but the pause made him laugh at himself. It serves me right, he thought. In his mind, he went over the records the monks had set and realized there was one missing. He turned to Croton. What is the record for Mountain Gyo? Asked Brad.
I've done 10,000 twice, came Torek's reply. It made me late for breakfast and Sensei told me 5,000 was enough. You're welcome to break it, and I promise I won't take it away from you.
You can keep your record, said Brad, revolted by the idea of sitting on a rock and chanting for 12 hours just to say he did it. He shook his head and started feeding himself. A night came when Brad and Ellie were invited to join the master for a private tea ceremony the following day after lunch. Besides the cheerful old man who believed in Aku and animal spirits, only Tenshin was present. She had set the table and poured their tea.
My monks have been very dedicated for years and have followed the training I provided them. They have chanted for world peace and provided service for the visitors to the temple, yet none of them have become enlightened.
Ellie translated for Brad as Sensei spoke.
I am afraid I will get old and die and no one will be the new temple master.
The Rosedales could say nothing other than to thank the master for his service. But inside, Brad yearned to attain the final enlightenment, an experience that would stay with him, what Adyashanti called an abiding awakening. It wouldn't happen from doing gyo. The monks were proof of that. Even with his limited experience, he could imagine settling into a new comfort zone with the arduous spiritual practices. He didn't have the nerve to say it to Sensei, but he would return to California, dedicate himself to attaining enlightenment, and finally beat the monks. Then he would return to the temple to show Sensei that he did it and have him recognize his achievement. Perhaps the Shingon Buddhist master would be his new guru and proclaim him to be an enlightened monk who could teach others. It made a grand and wonderful fantasy.